Aditi, thank you for joining today, and we're very excited to talk to you because what you're building with Kalara is very differentiated, new, and much needed, as we discussed, right, in our country and from our country. So why don't you tell everyone what you're doing at Kalara?
Kalara is, simply put, a wholesale e-commerce marketplace that enables small producers, manufacturers, SMEs from India, but also across South Asia, Southeast Asia, to export to small to mid-size to even large wholesale buyers around the world. And for both parties to effectively do business in a way that is convenient and reliable. So Kalara as a platform is an intermediary platform. And we enable mutual discovery between both parties. We enable the actual commerce on the platform. And we take care of end-to-end supply chain from the producer till the buyer anywhere in the world. We focus currently primarily on home and lifestyle categories. So home textiles, furnishings, home decor, furniture, fashion accessories, jewelry, wellness products. But we intend to be actually category agnostic. We intend to venture into any category that we believe this part of the world has a manufacturing edge in. We will do both finished goods as well as also intermediary materials like fabrics, essential oils, and so on. Our intention is not to be a niche player. Our intention is to build a large, scalable platform and, you know, contribute to global trade from this part of the world.
Aditi, I want to understand, because what you're doing is big, audacious, and of course needed. What are some of the learnings? Because you were the COO at Ajio.com, which had a very significant scale and revenue. What were some of the key learnings that you had, you know, while building marketplaces and e-commerce business in India, which led to Kalara?
Sure. So, you know, I'll just talk a little bit about my professional journey. So I graduated from Pilani, a fairly idealistic student. I was part of student politics and perhaps was one of the few to join the social venture space straight out of Pilani. We were enabling education in rural areas in the middle of Chambal Valley, in fact. And then went on to work with Ashoka, which is the world's largest network of social entrepreneurs. And at the time, while I was inspired and amazed by the work that social entrepreneurs did, the question that plagued me was, how do you scale this? You know, how do you scale the impact of individual entrepreneurs or social entrepreneurs? And therefore, I decidedly, you know, said that I must learn from organizations that have scaled and businesses that have scaled. And then decided to go on to do an MBA. And post that, you know, decidedly again, joined a large company, retail, Reliance Retail at the time was, of course, new to retail. This was back in 2011. It was a new entrant. But of course, had very ambitious plans at the time, right? And the first few years I spent on the brick and mortar side of retail, right? And I was very lucky to have an opportunity to really see the growth of a brick and mortar business in terms of, you know, what it means to build distribution, what it means, like physical distribution, you know, to look at sourcing from a buyer perspective, to have, you know, to look at the manufacturing ecosystem, largely in India at that time, in the fashion and lifestyle space, to understand what the economics of this business looks like, right? And then I had the opportunity to look at e-commerce. It was actually the first e-commerce venture out of Reliance, and launched just before Jio. And of course, Jio, I think, led a huge transformation within Reliance as well. But that, I think, really complemented what I'd learned in the prior years, with an exposure to, you know, building a technology product, e-commerce supply chain, which is very different from a B2B, you know, distributor supply chain, customer acquisition, digital marketing, which is a whole different animal. And I think really it is, in many ways, what I'm trying to do with Kalara now is a convergence of, you know, having worked with social entrepreneurs or in small remote areas in my early career, with an understanding of buying as a retailer in my initial part with Reliance, and then of course e-commerce at Ajio, right? So at every stage, what I've seen and experienced, built, or made mistakes have definitely, you know, contributed. There are still new aspects to what we're trying to build. Cross-border, you know, is a relatively new animal. Cross-border supply chain has tremendous amount of complexities, especially when we are dealing with such a wide variety of categories, products, materials, and supplying them to a wide range of countries that have different laws, different taxation duty structures, customs requirements, and so on. But I definitely credit, like, you know, just the convergence of all the experiences that I've had to what we're building now.
The complexity when it comes to, and again, this is maybe a little different question than on Kalara, but a macro question maybe, is that, you know, in India, we have such amazing, one is the talent, second is, you know, artisans and craftspeople producing such amazing high quality stuff. Why do you think that till now, the Indian products, Indian brands have not found a global marketplace?
You know, I think about that a lot. In fact, my starting point was, you know, this desire to build a global consumer brand that is intrinsically Indian. I think many Indians aspire to, many entrepreneurs aspire to do that today, right? I do believe that, I think just the sheer, of course, I think there are companies that have tried and I think some that have also achieved that to some extent. But I think it is, Shada, I think it is our generation, right, that really has had the confidence to kind of venture out and you know, pursue that kind of an ambition today. And I think access to capital, access to quality talent, access to channels like digital marketing that, I mean, or digital channels, not digital marketing per se, but that, you know, potentially allows us to scale faster than traditional methods. And also, I think to a great extent, in fact, one of the reasons I thought this was a good time to start Kalara is I do think in the last 5 to 7 years, thanks to Instagram, Pinterest, Facebook, there's definitely been a bridging of the information asymmetry across markets, right? Today, a manufacturer here knows what is selling, you know, in Anthropology, in Pottery Barn, at what price point, what are the best sellers on Wayfair, you know, or Amazon for that matter, again, at what price points, where is it made, you know, where did it originate? So I do think that that bridging of information asymmetry, the availability of channels, technology and digital channels to have access and to have that kind of reach, I think makes that possible today more so than, you know.
And as you rightly said, that today as entrepreneurs, yeah, we, like, you know, I keep on talking to entrepreneurs and then I see that shift also, right? Like today we can very unapologetically dream very audaciously, which maybe earlier generations could not.
Now, I was thinking also in the context of, you know, when you said India creates such beautiful things, I think that, and this is sort of my hypothesis, right, that again, because of this information, the bridging of this divide, there's also, I think, a convergence of aesthetic around the world. Like if you sit in a restaurant or a pub in Bangalore, you could be sitting in one in California. And I think also our generation and the younger generation definitely has, you know, is now building products that are beautiful, that are functional and relevant to a modern lifestyle anywhere in the world.
Yeah.
I think more so than, again, ever before. So your products are increasingly becoming globally marketable, just inherently, because our lifestyles are converging around the world.
You're so very true. Such an important insight. Yeah. Aditi, tell us, give us an inside view of what's happening in Kalara. Tell us about your team. Tell us about how you're building the technology, supply chain, because it sounds very complex, right? Like what you're trying to do is very complex.
Shraddha, we're still early stage. It's a small team. We're around 35, 40 people across technology and the sourcing piece, which is critical for us. Since we're a two-sided marketplace, it's as important for us to build selection as it is for us to build the demand side. So these three, along with supply chain, are really the core pillars. In terms of, from a technology perspective, you know, it is open stack, open source. We're using, you know, the latest technology stack and all of that. But I think in terms of just sheer features and functionality, apart from what I think most e-commerce platforms would build, a couple of the things that, you know, we are solving is things like how do you calculate in real time a landed price for a small business buyer, right? Mm-hmm. So actually determining freight and duties in real time seamlessly in a checkout flow is actually a very tough problem to solve for many reasons. One is that we do two kinds of products. We do ready to ship inventory as well as custom manufacturers or manufactured or just in time manufactured products, right? Now, in the checkout flow, to estimate what will be the precise final dimensions of the shipment, like volumetric dimensions, as well as the weight, because those are the two variables you need to determine freight costs, is very imprecise. Like it will never be precise at the time of, checkout. Like until you've actually packed the goods, you will actually never know that number precisely. And also then accurately estimating the duties and taxes, because most of our orders have a combination of products in them. What that means is that, you know, different countries or each country will have a different taxation structure for different materials, different products. Then accurately estimating that and therefore, you know, making it easy for protecting the supplier in terms of the cost that is quoted, as well as the buyer to understand what will be the actual cost, end-to-end cost to them, and therefore whether they'll be able to, you know, price it for retail with the desired margins is a fairly tricky problem to solve. And that's something that we focus on a lot. We want to simplify cross-border pricing. It should be as easy as doing B2C commerce. Now, there's an additional layer of complexity to it that even the base product pricing varies by the quantities that a buyer orders. You order lower quantities, prices tend to be higher. You order higher quantities, prices tend to be lower. So the checkout flow and the experience is actually wildly different. And then once you try and cater to the needs of a larger buyer, then you're talking about even more involved enterprise integrations, because then there is a, you know, a procurement process, there are purchase orders and so on and so forth. So that is really where a lot of our time kind of, you know, currently goes as a team, to really figure out how do we break this down, how do we simplify it, you know, for both sides of the marketplace. And then, of course, then there is the question of actually delivering on the on our promise, right?
Yeah.
Especially for, again, manufactured products. We currently take the onus of ensuring that products are produced on time, the right quality, and is essentially what was promised to the buyer, and then take care of the end-to-end supply chain. And what that entails is, you know, whether it's air freight or ocean freight, the documentation required towards both origin customs clearance as well as the destination customs clearance, and, you know, making sure it all happens on time. Currently, you know, as you might have caught in the papers, there's a significant surge in freight costs. It is unlike, again, domestic commerce, where freight is a very predictable cost. In case of cross-border, it is not. You know, you often get ocean freight quotes that are valid for a certain period of time, but when we are manufacturing, the lead times may well exceed that. So yes, I think you know, it's a small team, but it's a very involved team in you know, in kind of solving both the checkout problems as well as the supply chain related issues.
Yeah, you know, when you're saying, I can just imagine what this would entail. That brings me to the question, did you study other cross-border platforms? Because, you know, at least in the startup world here in India, we've not seen very scaled, and I could be wrong, but not found very, very scaled cross-border platforms. And do you think these complexities also make it challenging to scale?
So I think, you know, like one thing that I learned at Reliance is that scale solves a lot of problems. So the endeavor is always to scale. I think Alibaba has, and that ecosystem has definitely scaled massively. There is, you know, Fair in the US that is also, you know, I think scaling pretty impressively. And I do subscribe to that theory, Shraddha, that, you know, once you do that, you have a certain, you know, negotiating leverage across parties. There are things that you can do, you know, that are, you know, are suddenly give you more greater degrees of control and predictability, right? Which is what we're trying to solve for.
But you were in Reliance, and Reliance, if I may say so, is an investor.
Yes, so this is a Reliance, it's a completely Reliance-backed entity. I think I've been, again, like I said, very fortunate from an employee to an investee. And I think also for the business, it's incredible, right? It's like there's so much synergy to leverage, you know, from a company like this, from a company that I have been part of, that I know and understand. I have on the board, you know, people who I have a lot of respect for, whose brains I can pick, you know, when I'm trying to solve certain problems, who built large scalable businesses themselves. So yes, I think it's pretty amazing.
You know, and if I have to ask you, Aditi, what's the, like, of course, things change and journeys evolve, but as of today, what's the big vision, if you had to say? big vision, big dream that you're looking?
You know, I think you know, again, when I kind of started Clara, when I was thinking about it, it really was, as someone put it, like, looking for my life's work, right? I think many people go through a midlife crisis trying to figure out what am I doing with my life. So to me, I think, again, this was really a coming together of the many things I want to do. You know, I want to place India on the map. I want to place Indian design at par with Scandinavian or Japanese design in a very modern way. I want to be able to build a platform that contributes to global trade in a meaningful way. I want to be able to contribute to sustainable consumption, right? There are just so many pieces of this that inspire us every day with every order. You know, we just shipped cowbells from Dutch to Australia. It's pretty amazing. Like, you just the range of, you know, products, the range of the kinds of manufacturers, suppliers we work with, the range of the buyers we're helping, new businesses set up, like new entrepreneurs set up new businesses, to more established companies who want to substitute existing products with eco-friendly products. There's just like a wide spectrum,
yeah,
on both sides. Companies who, yeah, want to work only with fair trade suppliers. Company who want transparency in supply chain. I think for me, the vision is really to build something of you know, that something of scaled, meaningful impact, and then a little bit of patriotism in there.
You know, I just wanted to ask, when you answer this question, that the it's a cross-border, and this is for my information, that cross-border platform is for buyers from across the world, or buyers from India can also buy?
So it is for any wholesale buyer, but our focus is really buyers from outside the world. Because we feel that there is significant opportunity to unlock and lots of pain points to solve in that specific problem statement.
Yeah. And Aditi, will you have like a rough estimate or a figure that how big is the market, cross-border wholesale,
you know,
marketplace?
There are several numbers to this. If you were to slice it by global trade in these categories, in this lifestyle categories, it's in terms of retail. So I'm talking in retail. It's over $1 trillion. So even if you were to take a 40% of that, it's over $400 billion. If you look at B2B cross-border commerce, which of course encompasses a much wider variety of industries, again, over $1 trillion, right? If you look at subcategories that are traditionally exported from India, each category will be, billions of dollars, right? So the way I kind of, you know, looked at it is that, or if you look at what an Etsy estimates alone for its retail is about $250 billion, right? Or what a Fair estimates is about upwards of $600 billion. So to me, really, it was a sizable market, any which way that you slice it, look to capture, across a wide spectrum of categories, increasing share progressively.
Personally, for you, this is, if I can say, this is, you have been entrepreneurial after college. You've done, you've taken different paths all along, but today, you know, as the founder of Clara, as an entrepreneur, if I may say so, what's the most, personally for you, what's the most exciting thing about doing what you do every day?
For me, I think it's just two aspects. I think this daily feeling of fulfillment, which I think I was craving, right? Of course, you know, it was interesting work that I've done in the past. But I think this just more directly feels, you know, like that we are, you know, able to make an impact, you know, in a very direct way. The other is that it is extremely challenging. So it is very intellectually stimulating, right? In the nature of the problems that we're trying to solve. And I think it's that combination which is lethal, right? Like it just motivates me tremendously. Just the combination of the two.
Yeah, and last, what does Kalara mean?
Oh, okay. So it's a sort of a hybrid of Kala, which is art, and Era, which is earth. So we kind of blended the two and we use Q because it's easier to get domain names.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Aditi. This was, I learned a lot through, because, you know, the word cross-border marketplace has, it sounds very exciting, but I think with you today, we've gone deeper. And also with Kalara, what you are building is something I think we all in the country should root for. And we'll all be very proud, because at the end of the day, this is taking from India to the world. And yeah. So thank you.